through our pipeline projects, we're addressing two of the fundamental limitations overall on psychedelics and building a class of psychedelic medicine that I think is going to be far superior to the classics.
Ronan Levy joins me now, co-founder and executive chairman of Field Trip Health, trading on NASDAQ under the symbol FTRP. Ronan, welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure to have you, Ronan. Since you were here last in June, there's been quite a number of developments on the corporate front. Give me an update. What's the most exciting happenings at Field Trip in the last few months?
Yeah, well, there's been a lot going on since we last in June. Certainly, we listed on NASDAQ, which was a big step for us. We listed on the CSE initially last October, uplisted to the TSX in June, and we're on the NASDAQ in July, which has been great. Really, I think, validated a lot of the work we're doing internally in terms of brands. We can act on our strategy. We have our two divisions, if you recall, Trip Health, which is building out the clinical infrastructure to deliver psychedelic therapies. We're operating in Toronto, New York, LA, Chicago, Atlanta, Houston, Seattle, Vancouver, Fredericton. We're opening up in San Diego, so we continue to expand on that front, and everything's going really smoothly there. Not quite as disruptive, because now it's just focused on execution and continuing to open on a consistent basis. I think the more exciting stuff that's happening within Field Trip is on our Field Trip Discovery side, the drug development division, where we've got two great initiatives. The first one is FT104, our first molecule in development. We expect to be in phase one clinical trial early next year, so first trials in man, and hope to have those completed and read out before the end of the year. So we'll have great validation on that, though we're feeling quite confident on that. And then in our quarterly, we announced a new pipeline project, the FT200 series. And what's really exciting about the FT200 series is that there are kind of two main limitations or challenges with the classic psychedelics. One is the duration of action, and we're solving for that FT104, which has a much shorter duration of action. The one is called the 2B liability. And when psychedelics, classic psychedelics, taken frequently or in too high doses, it can create a cardiovascular risk. And what we have in our 200 series are molecules that are as potent as the classic psychedelics in terms of the psychoactive psychotropic effect, but with significantly reduced 2B activity, which means we've really addressed that 2B liability. So I think through our pipeline projects, we're addressing two of the fundamental limitations overall on psychedelics and building a class of psychedelic medicine that I think is going to be far superior to the classics. Not that anything necessarily bad about the classics, but I think a lot better than exactly what we're doing with Field Trip.
Right. So at all of your nine clinics, are you actually actively treating patients from the general public?
Yep. As soon as the clinic opened, we're working with people. A vast majority of people we're seeing are depression patients, but we treat people with anxiety, PTSD, eating disorders as well. In fact, the results we're seeing in clinics are quite remarkable. Now, admittedly, this is only an internal study, so it hasn't been validated or published. But in our internal review of people's results and improvements, what we're seeing is the average person who comes into our clinic goes from severe depression symptoms down to mild depression symptoms after one or two sessions. And after course of treatment, benefits are sustained for close to 120 days. As far as I'm aware, there is no depression treatment out there as effective as what we're offering within Field Trip. And this is notable. We take a slightly different protocol than what you teach about other ketamine IV infusion centers, where they just treat ketamine like a drug, because we're pairing it so closely with psychotherapy. Our results suggest that our treatments are offering benefits up to 3 to 4 or 5 times longer than ketamine IV infusions. So it really gives credence to the protocols we've developed within Field Trip.
Uh-huh. So help me understand, just for example, using the psilocybin analog, what is removed from the experience of a psilocybin psychedelic trip through the use of a isolated molecule relative to the actual fungal matter?
It's a good question. Not fully understood exactly how the difference between using the mushroom itself versus an isolated psilocybin, isolated T104, will have an impact. It's likely, like we said with the cannabis industry or cannabis, that the entourage effect in cannabis seems to lead to slightly better outcomes than just an isolated THC or CBD. It seems plausible that you would see that natural psilocybin is aesthetic, but all the studies to date, all the results that we see that suggest that psilocybin-assisted therapy can provide up to 5 years of depression relief, maybe not in totality, improvements, have all been done on psilocybin. So when we're comparing apples to apples, the results are fantastic. If we compare synthetic psilocybin to T104, again, we're working from incredible results already. So no one's really looked at synthetic versus natural, and maybe there might be slight improvements, natural product. Maybe not. We don't know. The real question is, how effective is psilocybin? And the studies using synthetic psilocybin are the ones that are really establishing the standards, showing incredible results.
Mm-hmm. The psychedelic mental health sort of treatment universe has become quite crowded of late. And I'm curious as to your opinion as to how many players can the industry support? Is this something that there's room for everyone, or is it more a case of this is where everybody rushes in and through a process of attrition, ultimately the more successful ones will prevail while the pretenders to the throne will not succeed?
Yeah, I think anytime you have an industry such excitement, such promise, you're going to have a lot of people rushing in to participate. I do expect that over the next couple of years, you'll see both consolidation as well as the weaker players probably get squeezed out of the industry. From my perspective, just looking at from an investor lens, I would be looking at companies that management that has a track record of success, companies that are focusing on novel products for which the IP is clearly articulated and understood. One, file for a patent and get a patent issued. It's a thing to actually generate IP and technology that's meaningfully different. So what's exciting about FT104 from our perspective is that FT104, for which we have to have the issue, we shipped it by June of this year at the latest, and all feedback so far has been very positive. We've got a differentiated molecule that has different effect that for which we will have a composition of matter patents. It's like, that's robust IP. Just having a patent is valuable. It has to be meaningfully different technology. The drug has to work differently than the others out there. And that's what we have here. So if I was an investor, I look for companies whose IP strategy is well articulated, where I can understand it, and the differentiation is clearly meaningful.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You reported financials, Q2 financials on November 15th, and you reported a loss of 23 cents a share. I'm curious as to when do you see the company becoming profitable?
Yeah, it's going to be a while before we become profitable. That's not necessarily a common performance of our clinics, which are going much in line with expectations overall. It's the nature of development. You know, the clinics can churn out great cash flows, but to get a drug from inception through to the phase 3 clinical trials probably costs $200-$300 million, and typically. So as much as the clinic business may start turning positive cash flows and revenues, overall combined entity, we don't anticipate profitability for a while, but that's just the nature of all biotech and drug development. Once we get FT104, the first case, through phase 2, phase 3, we'll be getting a lot sort of profitability. We're probably still talking about 4 to 5 years. That being said, we do expect the clinics business to continue to ramp on a healthy basis and hope to start to contribute to positive cash flows, at least on that division, in the next year or so.
Uh-huh. Okay. And then in 2022, what are your big sort of milestones that you're going to hit that will be representative of increased shareholder value?
So in 2022, what we're really looking forward to is getting FT4 into phase one clinical trials. I think that'll be a big milestone for us. It'll validate all the preclinical toxicology work that we've done, all the manufacturing we've done. And I think before the end of the year, we'll see the first readouts from our phase one clinical trials on FT104. We anticipate will be positive. I expect we'll have positive news on an IP for FT104 early in the year. So we anticipate being granted full composite matter patents around FT104, which are the most robust IP you can get. And we want to really continue to execute on FT200 series. You know, we started that pipeline project. We narrow in on a lead molecule, a lead candidate, probably in the first half of next year, and get all the work done to get that into phase one clinical trials, hopefully early in 2023. That's still a bit of a moving target, but that's what we're aiming for right now. On the clinic side, we'll continue the expansion. We'll continue to help people show results, validate psychedelic medicine as a class of medicine and a really important element of the future of psychiatry. And I think those would be the two drivers for Field Trip in the coming year.
Okay, great. Ronan, we're going to leave it there for now. I really appreciate the update. We'll come back to you in due course. Thanks for your time today.
Thank you for having me.
You bet. Bye for now.